Actually, that's an interesting question, but I would like to take it from what Ashish said. Because this whole debate about low tariff is actually getting boring actually, because we discuss the same issue in every conference and we go and bid for a lower tariff. Okay. In fact, I'll tell you a very interesting story that I was talking to a very retired senior bureaucrat who follows this sector, and there was an announcement of new low bid coming in. And at the same time, the news channels were running about a soldier complaining about some watery dal. उनका कहना था आपके सिचुएशन इनकी तरह है, बिकॉज व्हेन यू हैव कमिटेड योरसेल्फ टू द नेशनल कॉज डोंट कंप्लेन अबाउट द वॉटर रिजर्व. सो गिवन दैट, आई मीन जोक्स अपार्ट, बट आई थिंक फ्रॉम अ फाइनेंशियल मॉडलिंग परस्पेक्टिव द इक्विपमेंट प्राइसेस हैव कम डाउन, द कॉस्ट ऑफ कैपिटल इज रिड्यूस्ड, जनरली द कमोडिटी प्राइसेस हैव ऑल्सो कम डाउन इन लास्ट 3 ईयर्स. सो फ्रॉम अ फाइनेंशियल मॉडलिंग पार्ट, वी बाय कॉम्प्रोमाइजिंग कपल ऑफ पॉइंट्स ऑन द आईआरआर, we are able to make to this tariff. But there are a lot of, since India is an emerging market and the market is evolving, both on the regulation side, from the economic side, and other factors as well. The question which we face on the board is, what about those qualitative factors? Are we pricing that risk in? For example, today we have a new tax law. I mean, we are staring at a tax law being implemented 1 month down the line, but still we struggle here. I mean, there's a set of views that 18% hai ke 5% hai, kisi ko pata nahi hai. So that's one of the qualitative factors. Similarly, the other qualitative factor is, today we are talking about a model quality, you know, requirement. There's a draft guidelines which is coming. I mean, I don't understand the logic of this whole thing, because till now we have been saying that, okay, we have been importing and the developers are putting the performance guarantees linked to the performance of the project. So if that be the logic, then why do we need a model quality at the first place? Now, if this model quality restricts some of the imports, then that is going to have consequential impact on your projects as well. Same is the question about the grid. Okay, and I mean, we have seen grid curtailment in different states, but we don't have quantitative numbers to put into the financial model. The fourth issue is, of course, the low tariff is causing a huge problem for the backlog of projects which have been, for which the PPA has been signed or the LOAs have been issued, which is at 50% premium to the current price. So I don't expect any of our utilities or the off-takers, especially SECI or NTPCs, to default on the PPA. But given a grid curtailment situation, what will be the set of priorities? You know, so these are the things which we don't factor into. So from a financial modeling perspective, yes, this can be met. But when these questions are asked the board about the qualitative issues, we have few answers.
No, absolutely. I think that you hit the nail on the head. You're right. I think that the low tariff, in a sense, are good for the sector. We have seen the maximum amount of foreign interest now, because now, you know, with a 2.5 rupee kind of a tariff, the biggest risk which was always talked about in the Indian solar sector was DISCOM finances. At 2.5 rupees, you don't need to worry about DISCOM finances, because even the average revenue realization for a DISCOM in the country at an average is around 3 rupees, you know, while its kind of average power procurement cost is somewhere around 3.5. So when a DISCOM is therefore procuring power at 2.5, the chances that he's not going to pay you seems very, very less. Obviously, you know, there are other political factors sometimes that come into play. Similarly, I think so Shailendra hit the point on the net, I think so, and what Mr. Munda also referred to. To be fair, since the Enron in early 1990s, not a single rupee of default has happened to any private power sector developer in the country. I think that's something that is to be, yes, there have been delays, yes, there have been issues, and there is obviously a long way to go before we can meet the developed market standards in terms of, you know, certainty, contract enforcement, you know, payment securities, yes, but there has never been a default, and we would hope that just because you know, the new tariff is 2.5, but you know, PPA signed at 5 rupees or 5.5 rupees does get honored still. And again, you know, you don't take to out of book solutions like grid curtailment to kind of, you know, bypass that. I think that's very important. One of the recommendations that Yes Bank has actually made to the MNRE is, now that at 2.5, the new utility scale really does not require any concession from the government, right? We don't require a viability gap funding, we don't require any special cesses. In fact, now one of the uses of the National Clean Energy Fund could be to support the DISCOMs who actually led to the situation where we are here. Just imagine a situation. Today, in a sense, it's an unfair system. The DISCOMs who took a lead for developing solar in India, the Gujarat DISCOMs, etc., people who paid 15 rupees, 17 rupees, they have the high cost PPAs which they have to honor for 25 years. While the, you know, the laggards, the DISCOMs who did not ever, you know, support solar, today they get the advantage of a 2.5 rupee or a 3 rupee tariff, right? So it's only fair now that a financial incentive mechanism is worked out where the existing DISCOMs are kind of compensated to ensure that they continue to honor their PPAs. Rest assured, all these foreign money, all the low tariff, all the reduced risk perception will evaporate if any of those DISCOMs try to kind of renege on their PPAs. You know, for possibly, you know, 2 gigawatts of high cost capacity, we are going to jeopardize the entire 100 gigawatt program, you know, in case you kind of renege on those contracts. I suppose that's extremely important that, you know, these things are taken care of. Vikas, just coming, you know, Vikas again coming to you on, you know, when you again look at, Mr. Moon mentioned some of the issues. Again, how does Trina Solar kind of factor that when you look at your development plan there in India? Do you see it as a rapidly improving situation and therefore these are risks that an emerging country always possesses? How do you kind of, how are you looking at these issues?
So I think we started the discussion with the global map, what's happening around the world, and Trina being a global company, I can also share some of the insights which would be useful for the people sitting here to understand what's happening in other parts of the world. And then I can definitely come back to your question of convincing the management. It is actually convincing yourself more than convincing the management. Because, you know, the guy who is responsible for the business, he will be answerable for that business. So there is no question of going to your higher up, your bosses, and telling them to do it if you yourself are not convinced. Anyway, so coming back to the global scenario, I think very common point which I would say is that the prices around the globe are hovering around $3 to $4 a unit. You know, that is a fact of life today. Trina has more than some 300 megawatts in Japan. Japan still is a very good market, although the FIDs have come down by 50%. But it still is a very, very good market, very, I would say, low risk market, very predictable market. And you know that how Japanese work. You know, they are the normal life cycle of developing a solar plant is around 3 to 4 years. It's not like India where you finish everything in 1 year. It's about 3 to 4 years time. We are in Mexico where we have recently won a bid for 130 megawatts. Again, around $3. Very, very competitive market. And probably the module prices are the lowest in Mexico in the world. Vietnam, Philippines are coming out as a good markets. Of course, Philippines has a problem of land and then transmission lines. Vietnam is also considered to be a good market these days. Middle East, of course, everybody is now eyeing Middle East. But Middle East guys have their own, you know, mindsets. Sometimes they go towards oil, then they come back to renewable, then they go back to oil. If the oil is good, they go to oil. Otherwise, they come back to renewables, you know. So the point is that whatever money they have earned in oil, naturally, they would not be interested in just throwing it off by having some brilliant, shiny panels, you know, installed on that desert. But Middle East is still is a good market. India, of course, has always been a big market. It is good, big market for everything, whether it is a cab driving agency or it is a, you know, online e-commerce guy, whatever. I mean, people are having revenue of 600 crores. With a loss of 1800 crore, is still they are having series 4, series 5 fundings. Why? Because it's a $1.25 billion people country. Everybody knows that these people will continue to draw some, you know, these resources. So let's go and invest there with the hope that someday some investor will come and take us over. That is the only thing that I can think of, you know. Otherwise, there is no point in investing in a business which has been constantly making losses, and the losses are going up and up and up. Coming back to your point of, you know, how to convince people about these financial models and about the falling tariffs. So I think tariff is something which we should never ever be worried about. Tariff is just a number, you know. It was sometimes 8.5, now it is 2.5. Someday it may go to 50 paisa also. Let's not bother for that. There are few variables in the financial model which are key, which if you can manage those numbers, then you are there. So presently, when I saw this Badla bid, we also have bid for Badla. Before that, 250 megawatt Kadapa was won at 3 rupees 15 paisa. 3 weeks after, somebody has won a 50 megawatt project at 2 rupees 62 paisa. What changed? Did the module prices fall down? Did the copper price fall down? Did the structure price fall down? Nothing. Even Badla was, you know, in many senses, it was more expensive than Kadapa. And just after 2 days, the same guys who stopped at 2.63, they came down to 2.44. What changed? What happened? Did anything change? So it is actually for a developer. I mean, those who are not developers, just to tell them that how developer community works. First is that you have committed certain capital. The foreign companies have thought that India is a great market. Let's go there. Let's do the business. Let's put some people there. Let us ask them to win some projects, 100 megawatt, 500 megawatt, 1 gigawatt, whatever. Build a portfolio, deploy this capital. So there is a team. There is a commitment to the board. People have to do something. So what they are trying to do, they are making assumptions. If you go to Yes Bank guys, are they going to give you something in writing that we are going to refinance your project in 8%? They will never do it. They say it is your problem. You make the assumption. So what people have done here, today the panel prices are 31.5, right? Dollar cents in India. Can you do a project at 2.44 with 31? So what you did? You made an assumption of 23, you made an assumption of 22. Did anybody give it to you in writing that I am going to give it at 22? Nobody. So it is only an assumption which is driving the entire fact, entire market. And developers are taking that risk. The risk is ultimately passed on to my friends and in the EPC group or the module manufacturers. In fact, during this bidding also, a lot of people went to China and asked our CEO chairman if you can give us, and he refused. He said, it's not possible for me to give that. So this is, what I'm trying to say is that it is just an assumption-driven market. Whoever is successful in meeting up with his assumptions, maybe after 1 year or 2 years, he will be successful. Otherwise, you will see that some more investors will come and take over these companies, like somebody is taking over some cabbies, you know, of cab companies or e-commerce companies. These type of consolidations are going to happen. So India has basically become an e-commerce market everywhere, whether it is solar industry or any other industry. This is what is happening.
Okay. So one thing to note down here is, I think one of the things that we clearly see is, you know, what explains this bidding behavior sometimes, as you mentioned, how can the price drop by 20% in 2 days? I think what we call it as a FOMO factor, that is fear of missing out. India is such a great kind of story today. Some of these, the players have a feeling that, listen, you know, if we are not building these projects, if we are missing out, we are missing out on the entire growth story. So even if on the financial model side, as you said, maybe our base case assumptions, you know, we are not possible, let's take the aggressive assumption, but let's go ahead. There is no point sitting on the sideline and watching the sector kind of grow the way it has been growing. Just one thing on the debt side, I would just like to make, you know, so one of the famous questions that always keeps coming as a lender we have to answer is, sir, will you finance projects at 2.44? Sir, will you, you know, the same question was asked, sir, will you finance projects at, you know, 4.23? So our simple question is, listen, we finance projects based on DSR, you know, based on the debt service coverage ratio. As long as, you know, at a P90 I meet my 1.2, I will fund it. You know, as a lender, it doesn't matter to me whether the equity returns in the project are at 15% or at 10%. As long as my debt coverage is fine, as long as I have comfort on the project structure, the quality of the EPC, the quality of the the quality of the contract, the commitment of the promoters to bring in their equity capital, and also bring in their kind of, in case there is a cost over and etc., those contingencies, I will fund it. You know, I am not the, as a lender, I don't decide what the equity return in the market should be. But very clearly, as a lender, I also don't decide what the lending rates in the market should be. It is a function of risk. It's a function of macroeconomic. Today, we are possibly at the bottom of the interest rate curve in India. Maybe there is a view that another 25 basis point we can go further. So yes, you will get advantage of that. The risk in the sector, as you are all aware, is driven by the discom risk, etc. So if we see that getting down, our risk premium decreases. So very clearly, once again, a lending rate cannot decide the bid. It is the sector progress which decides the lending rate in terms of the macroeconomics and the risk factor. Pradeep?
Just a point here that you were mentioning that lending rate doesn't decide this entire financial modeling. You know, one very critical aspect which needs to be looked at is that when you are going for a bid, you get some comfort letter from a bank. But naturally, when you are actually going to build the project, the bank will ask you that you have put some $0.22 as the module price there. And based on that, your DSCR was 1.2 or 1.3, whatever was there. And now your module price is 24. So where is naturally you are going to hit the wall. The bank is not going to lend you. So this is certainly going to come up as a big issue. If somebody has not taken care of all these things in advance, because bank is not asking you to show them the evidence of 22 or 21. It is your assumption.
Absolutely. And at the time of at the time of appraisal, I will see if the model at that time does not reflect 22. Therefore, instead of lending you 70, I will be lending you 60, because the project can then only serve a 60 of cash flow. So that's fine. Pradeep, obviously INFS Group, in terms, if you just talk about renewable energy, you guys have a very kind of a large, I think you have a nearly a gigawatt portfolio on the wind side. On the solar side, obviously you have done the solar parks with the state government. But I think on the utility scale solar, I think you have one project in Gujarat, if I'm not wrong. So I think on the utility scale solar, you still have a smaller capacity compared to the size of the INFS Group. What's the thinking internally? Would you want to now go, big bang onto the utility solar in order to kind of balance the portfolio? Or do you believe now that maybe, as you mentioned, the group captive and the private PPAs is something that you would like to get into? What's your, plans around the solar side now?
So, Danish, this 100 gigawatt is too big for anybody to just look at one of the segment like bids. You can find space in private space, you can find space in captive, you can find space in microgrid, you can find space in storage solutions. It is one's appetite to take risk or to satisfy yourself with what kind of IRR you are satisfied. You are satisfied with 16 or you're 12. And at the recent bids which we also bid in the similar tenders, we have been able to see that it's not only that capital cost engineering is part of financial engineering also. So if developers have been able to bring in cheaper debt from some other foreign markets, it's good for the industry. Of course, utilities are going to be benefited. The mission is also getting benefited because you are definitely going to a larger scale. So, as a developer, we are trying to consolidate our portfolio into parks, into utility scale projects, into private space. We believe this is a niche market gray areas. If somebody can develop 100 megawatt sort of captive or private PPAs, that's going to be different. There is less competition there. So yeah, big plans. We have 2 gigawatt plans for next 3 years on private space.
Great. Thanks, Pradeep. Now, what I'm going to do is now ask each of my panelists to give me the one key big challenge which they face now as a developer. What is the key big risk, concern or challenge that you believe is the biggest thing in terms of, which could derail this kind of a growth story? But the key thing is, I'm going to mention three things which you are not allowed to say, because, again, we keep hearing them all the time. So DISCOM health, land acquisition and ROW issues, and grid curtailment. So beyond these three, which is the single biggest risk or concern factor you guys feel on the development side today?
Okay, but before we go to that question, I have a question for you. You said that you are financing a project based on
the debt service coverage ratio. And you, hello, yeah. What you said is that you are going to finance a project with a DSCR number of say 1.2 to 1.3, and you really do not bother about what is going to be the equity IRR, right?
Okay. With the condition that obviously, if the equity IRR is 1 or 2%, then obviously I don't have any question.
Fair enough. Fair enough. Okay. Okay. If you see in a project that the equity IRR is below the cost of capital for India, how do you get the additional comfort? Are you still doing a project financing, or you are going to a recourse-based financing? And what's been Yes Bank's approach on this subject? How many project financing deals you have done in this segment, in solar segment?
Okay. So, let me be very honest. Pure non-recourse project finance is a rarity in India. We have no qualms in developing it. Yes, during the construction phase, we do expect some bit of recourse. And I'll tell you, it's a very logical reason. Typically, this has been a kind of concern with most of the international developers, wherein they say in the Western market, they are used to pure non-recourse project finance. And you know what they are ready to typically give is, let's say, a 10% or a 20% kind of a cost overrun equity commitment guarantee. But you must understand, in India today, cost overrun is one side. So far anyways, cost overruns have been always on the lower side because the, you know, everything is falling. The challenge is not that. The challenge is implementation capabilities. Today, if you miss a deadline on commissioning, a 20% cost overrun guarantee does not save me. If your PPA gets cancelled or if your tariff gets revised to a lower level, what we saw in Tamil Nadu, where people who missed the 31st March deadline had the tariff reduced from 7.01 to 5. Any financial model will tell you a 20% equity drawdown does not save that project. You know, I lose that, right? So what we do is, we typically do insist for certain sponsor support during, till at least what we call as a project stabilization date, which is COD plus one. So this is a date by which all the teething problems in the projects are over, you know, the billing cycle has normalized, etc. So that's typically what we do. Post COD plus one, all your sponsor recourse is kind of fall away. But yes, it's not that we have not done pure non-recourse project finance. We have done that. Obviously, it's a factor on multiple factors. Obviously, whether it's a state bid versus a NVV and SECI, whether it's solar park, whether it's not, what's the status of land and ROW kind of a commitments, the quality of the EPC player, and the credential of the player. And here, a lot of times, we again get a lot of inquiries from first-time international developers. While they may have a 10 gigawatt capacity operating around the world, doing a project in India is a different animal altogether, right? So we look at the India experience, doing business in India, kind of an experience, ability to manage certain shocks, you know, which will be not there. So, sir, I'll be honest, I think if I have to try to put a percentage, my percentage would be a single digit percentage of projects where from the construction initiation, we have done a pure non-recourse project finance. But yes, refinancing of operational projects is being done on complete non-recourse. We have been doing a lot of debt capital market transactions. We were the first to do a credit enhanced solar bond, you know, with the ADB IFL facilities. I think the debt market is really opening up on the refinancing side now. But initially, yes, we need to get some comfort, purely because things are not under our control. You may have the tier 1 module, you may have a tier 1 EPC guy, you may have a solar park, but if some of the conditions are just not met, the entire project is in jeopardy and not just the project cost overrun. So coming back, so DISCOM risk, land acquisition, and grid curtailment. That's something you cannot say. Which otherwise do you feel is your biggest risk, concern, or challenge as a, you know, when you go about developing a pipeline today?
I think if you take out all the three you have said, then I think the next big challenge is the certainty of the conditions. Okay, so whatever condition in the PPA we are specifying, to what extent the government, the clients are going to stand by it, and how clear or how transparent and clear the conditions are. I just give you an example of GST, okay? Some of the operating projects now are going through the GST, okay? And for last, as a foreign developer, we have been approaching the government for last 4, 5, 6 months now, since the first date when GST was, talked about, to find out how we'll be treated, okay? Now, there is no answer, there is no certainty. Nobody tells you clearly that how you will be treated. So this is a simple thing. This is a new tax law which has come into the country. Obviously, at the time of bidding, it was not talked about. Okay. So this is a change in law provision. Now, whether the change in law will be implemented actually or not, nobody can give you an answer. So if this is a risk. This is a big risk for foreign developer like us, which we need to factor these into our future tenders. But the existing projects which we are doing, obviously we have to we feel that this is something. If there can be a comfort or at least a clarity, if not a comfort, at least a clarity, yes, this is the way it will be treated, then certainly it will be a big help, and at least it will elevate some of the risk apprehension of the foreign developers on Indian power sector. Thank you.
Yeah, I'll mention two, take less time probably. The first one is for every developer around, and what I have observed, we've done a very small project, but we heavily underestimate the time required to complete a project, and that's across board. I had a presentation actually on our learnings. We budgeted 10 months for a 5-megawatt project. People will laugh at us, right? That why would you take 10 months? In 2015, when we had not started the business, we were meeting EPC companies, the tier one, and the statements we would used to hear was, we completed 50 megawatts in 79 days. You know, solar project is no rocket science. And when we started building our own project and we wanted to build it in the way which we build project anywhere in the world. So to your point of whether you can do business in India, we can do business in India, but in the way we want to operate, it takes more time. So people should budget enough time for the uncertainties. Land acquisition, regulatory uncertainties are the biggest ones, but even on the technical and project management side, I don't see any budget for a failed pre-dispatch inspection in the project schedule. Do you have any probability of a pre-dispatch inspection not going right? So these are just a few examples. There is a huge rush, and the FOMO factor, which you said, I think is the biggest contributor of the rush of building a pipeline as soon as possible because you have capital committed. And if you don't use that capital, then the biggest risk is not taking any risk. So that's number one. For the business which we operate in, which is the private PPAs and the open market business, the biggest risk for us is regulatory uncertainty. No state in India today underwrites what will be the grid charges which a consumer or a generator has to pay, except Karnataka, which is given 10-year certainty on a few charges, but not all. There is no certainty on the timeline which it'll take to get open access approvals, or whether you will have open access approvals or not. So while since 2003, there has been an ambition to have an open market for power in India, I think it will still remain a dream. I joined StatCraft 5 years back, and my first impression was because StatCraft comes from Norway, which was the first country to liberalize power markets in the world. And they have a very different view of how they look at power sector. They feel power sector should be completely liberalized. And when I joined, I was asked, how much time do you think open access will take to come in full force? I said, at least 5 years. 5 years have passed. And I don't think even next 5 years we'll see that day. So that's the biggest risk for our business.
Oh, absolutely. I think you hit the nail on the head. I think with power prices now going below so much, I think the pressure on the DISCOM to kind of now safeguard its customers going else, given that they can possibly procure power at 2.5, and supply very profitably, it's going to increase. So I think a very strong regulatory kind of clarity is required that open access will become, a reality, and no artificial clauses like that Section 11 of of the Electricity Act, that emergency power rules are in play where no power can be exported out of the state. System constraint. And that has become a way to kind of bypass the regulations essentially.